Good morning, good morning. This is Jacqueline Richardson, Miss JJ Diamond, Deja, Jackie, whatever y'all call me. Oh, it's a beautiful morning. I got me some rest, so I feel so much better than I did yesterday. Yesterday I had a real bad day, but I was blessed to be alive, and I'm blessed to be alive today. So I'm thankful. It's just, you know, sometimes we have them days that it's just a bad day. The weather here today is like 77, going to be 77. It's cloudy here in Charlotte today, but it's pretty warm. It's pretty warm outside. Normally, this is the weather that we are used to here in Charlotte, where we got that little cold front that came in from the storms, really cooled it off, and that's something I'm not used to here in Charlotte, North Carolina. However, it's gone. That cold. But now I got to go back to this with these allergy issues, because when it's colder, my allergies are normally pretty good, you know, once I get over that hump. But I got to go back to it, and then I'm going to have to go back to going through the cold front again come November, you know, most likely late November. That's when we start seeing the trees fall off. I mean, the leaves fall off the trees. Here in Charlotte, and we have that autumn look. So it's normally around November here in Charlotte, North Carolina. Today, I wanted to talk about our family members that has passed away and our ancestors. I've lost a lot of family members. For y'all that do know me, you know, some of my friends went through me losing my family members. In the Bronx, you know, a lot of my friends was around at the time that I was losing my family members. And I've lost, okay, let me clarify everything. My little brother, no, my grandmother was the first to go, Grandma Doris. She was the first to go that I can remember, okay? Then my little brother, my Uncle Luther, my Aunt Alice, she was really my cousin, but she's my second cousin, so I always called her auntie, okay? She was my aunt to me, okay? Wani, Grandma Tina, then Wani. And my Uncle Gene. And after my Uncle Gene, then my mom. Okay, so those are the family members that I grew up with, and they're all gone. Okay. And you know, now that I am grown, especially 50 years grown, it's hard to deal, you know, when your family members are gone. You know, people don't understand me when I say they're all dead. They're all gone. You know, people try to act like I'm crazy, but I know my family members that died, and there's people that know my family members died. So when you're out there talking nonsense, you look crazy, okay? because I buried all these people, you know. Now, I want to talk about some of the things that came up after I buried all these people. You know, I went to get my family members' death certificates. Okay, I had to go to New York and get their death certificates. And it was really hard for me because there were things that I didn't know on their death certificates. There was things that I didn't know, but didn't realize I knew. Okay, this is how I found out that one of these men in my family was always there, and I didn't even know who he was, you know. And this is how I got my grandmother's death certificate to prove that we were from the Hispanic descent. She asked me at the death certificate place, what's your great grandmother's father's name? And I'm like, I don't know. My great grandmother's father, she didn't have a father. This is what I was thinking. And she said she had to talk about her father at least once, you know. So just think. Go sit down and think. think of some names that she's called. And I said, well, I don't have to sit down for that. I can, you know, tell you some things that she used to know, names that she called that I didn't know about. And the first name I said was Oscar. Okay. And she said, you got it. I said, I got it. She was like, yeah. She said, that's your grandmother's father's name, Oscar. And I was like, oh my God, all this time I was thinking that Oscar was her brother because he looked real young. He looked white. Okay, actually, I thought he was her brother, okay? And the whole time, he was her father. And he used to sit in a chair, really quiet. He came from Florida. I'll never forget when she picked him up from the airport. And he would sit in that chair and just sit there and watch TV. But I didn't know that that was her dad, okay? Until I got her death certificate, okay? I did know my grandmother told me about my grandfather. He was Cuban. He was from Cuba. So he was full-blooded Cuban. He brought a lot of his family members over with him from Cuba. And they all migrated to New York after he married my grandmother. And I didn't get to see that for a fact until I looked at her death certificate, which had his name, Emmanuel Rodriguez, on it. And for my grandmother, her father name was Emmanuel Rodriguez. And my Uncle Gene, his father was Emmanuel Rodriguez. So they were half Cuban. Okay. My grandmother married this man and they all migrated to New York. Some migrated to Buffalo, New York, and some migrated to New York City, and that's how my family was through the whole state of New York. However, I want to talk about us respecting our family name, you know, even though we may not like everything that our family does, you know, we still supposed to respect our family name and what they stand for, okay? My family, my grandmother, she worked, my great-grandmother, I'm talking about my great-grandmother now, Grandma Tina, that's Tina number one, and then we have Tina number two. Tina number two was my mother, okay? Tina number one was my great-grandmother, so I want y'all to understand that. Grandma Tina, and I was blessed to be and live with my great-grandmother, you know, for those that know, shout out to Harlem, a lot of them know my great-grandmother and knew what she stood for, you know. My grandmother was into the Negro Leagues very hard. You know, she was hard body with it, you know. She was in the church real hard, you know. even the fashion real hard. My grandmother was a fashion, what do they call it, fashionista? Okay, or fashionista, whatever how they say that. That was her life, okay. And my grandfather did that for her because he was an entrepreneur, okay? He was a business owner. He owned a funeral home, which is not in my league, y'all. I don't deal with the dead. However, I got the entrepreneurship through the blood of my Hispanic family. You know, this is what creates you, your ancestors, okay? And you wonder why am I like this? Why am I doing this? Why am I not like so-and-so, you know? And that's because of the blood that runs through your veins. Okay. And we have to learn to accept who we are. You know, sometimes we don't want to accept who we are and we want to, falsify our lives, you know, and I'm going to use my grandson for instance. You know, my grandson has more Hispanic in him than all of us because his father is Panamanian, okay? And then he has Cuban and then the black side, okay? And I also had told y'all before that my great-grandmother, my great-great-grandmother, okay, she was in the Native Indian log, okay, when I searched her name and I found her name, you know, in the log. So that's how I found out that I am Native Indian as well, you know, and I guess that's where the high cheekbones come in. the skin complexion, you know, and my skin changes. You know, sometimes y'all see me lighter, sometimes y'all see me darker, depending on if I've been out in the sun. And I couldn't understand, you know, why. Now, my mother's eyes was like a grayish blue, and then they would turn brown. Mine's don't turn grayish blue. Okay, mine's turned lighter brown to darker brown. Okay, and I couldn't understand why, you know. So I still don't know about my mother's side, if she has any white or is that all of the Cuban descent, okay, in her. Of course, I can't find out now because she's gone, but I'm going to do my research because I need to know who Jacqueline is, you know. But when it comes to the name, okay, your name. Now, I have two names in my family. One is Dowdy because my grandmother, Doris, she got married to someone and she took on his last name. And that's what we do. Women get married and they take on a last name. And that's how we got the name Dowdy. But she was born under the name of Doris Rodriguez. Okay. Now, I personally want to know about both sides. So I've been seeking out the Dowdy family. Okay, name, because I want to know who name I'm carrying, okay? Because my name is actually Jacqueline Dowdy, Jacqueline Yvette Dowdy, okay? I got married, and I decided to keep the name, similar to my grandmother Doris, and that name is Richardson. That's why y'all hear me say, this is Jacqueline Richardson, but my maiden name, that's why they call it a maiden name, the name that was under your ancestors is your maiden name, which is Dowdy, okay? And Dowdy was married into my family. I don't know if he was my grandmother's, my mother's father, or he was just a man that she married. I don't know. I didn't get that deep yet. I haven't found out yet. I haven't met any family members that do know the facts about the Dowdy name. But I do know that my family name is Rodriguez. Okay. So, you know, I was thinking about, because I don't know about this Dowdy person, to get rid of that name and follow under my Hispanic descent, because that's who I am and that's who I was able to find out about. Okay. I'm still contemplating y'all on that one, but where I'm going with this is, you know, we are made up of our ancestors, you know, and just because they die don't mean that you just forget about them. We have to stand strong for our family names, you know, and carry that name. You know, now we have some ancestors that might have wanted us to be, only God knows, you know, my family always wanted me to be successful. They worked hard to try to make sure I became successful, even though we had a lot of difficulties in our family, you know, but they were still strong about me being successful. They didn't know how I was going to be successful. They was always worried because I used to hang in the streets a lot. And I'll talk to y'all about that one day, you know, but they always wanted me to be successful. And I think that that's with any family, you know, they want their children to be successful, especially the smaller ones, whoever's coming up, the great grandparents, the grandparents, they want to make sure that this child is pretty much saved, okay, from the nonsense in the street. So, you know, with that being said, they teach and they teach and they teach, you know, and that's what I had to live with, being that I was born during the time that my great grandmother was alive, my grandmother was alive, my mother was alive. So I had these women constantly coming at me, you know, teaching me, my Aunt Alice. You know, they was always constantly teaching and teaching until they drilled all of this stuff in my head. Now, everything that each family member did wasn't a great thing to take on. And I'm going to just be honest with you, you know, because everybody has their faults. We're not perfect. You know, not everything that's done in families are good. And, you know, even though sometimes we follow them, that don't mean it's good. You know, I laugh about, you know, around Thanksgiving time, they got this meme where they say when we cooking our, you know, our Thanksgiving meal, you know, colored people, when we cooking our Thanksgiving meal, we keep pouring the seasoning to the ancestors tell us in our head to stop, you know. And I laugh about that because it's true, you know, because that's what our ancestors did. You know, they go in the kitchen and you be like, well, how much? And they like, just put enough and you can taste it, you know. So I think about them a lot when that meme come down the stream around Thanksgiving. And, I was with one of my clients. And I'm going to tell you this real quick and go back to what I was talking about. I was with one of my clients and, you know, she's white and she has a recipe log, you know, with cards and stuff. And she would say, Jackie, can you go get such and such recipe? Because this is what we're going to cook today. You know, she was wheelchair bound, so she wasn't able to physically come to the stove and cook the food. However, I had to do the cooking, but she would assist me with her recipe. So, and buy all the things that was needed. So, she said, well, get this particular spoon and get that particular spoon and measure the seasoning. And I looked at her real crazy, y'all. I was like, measure the seasoning? Okay. So now I got to measure the salt and the pepper. I'm not used to that. Okay. Because my people, they sprinkled it until, yet, like they said, the ancestors say stop. So I'm not used to that. But I would crack up because I was like, wow, you know, we are really like our ancestors, you know, and this is what my people used to do. And the food be wonderful. You would think that they knew exactly how much to put in that food, you know, and without measuring it. And it always worked because the food be banging. You be like, this stuff is good. This is why colored people are the best cooks. You know, because we don't measure our stuff, you know. But we also eat a lot of stuff that was bad for us, you know. And those are the things that I had to look at that my ancestors were doing to themselves based on the illnesses that they had and they passed away and left me here. Okay, because I'm actually, you know, angry about it. You know, I try not to be, but why y'all leave me here by myself? This ain't right. But I carried them with me every single day. I carried a name with me every single day. And being that my people were popular, like I told y'all, my grandfather, he was popular in New York City because he owned a funeral home. So every dead person that came his way, you know, the people knew him, you know? And there's a lot of funeral homes in New York, but people came his way and the families knew him, so he got respect from that. My grandmother, she was big into the Negro League, so, you know, she got a lot of respect from that. You know, my great-grandmother, she was a seamstress. Well, she sold, you know, she was into fashion. She made a lot of clothes. She used to have a lot of material, you know. People knew her for that, and they knew her for other things, too, okay? But that was who she was, you know. And then I didn't find out until I got her death certificate that she worked for the city of New York before, you know, in the past, you know. So these are things that I didn't know about my family because they didn't talk about it. And my grandmother had got sick and was on disability. So I didn't know she used to work for the city of New York before she got on disability. So that was something that I was able to learn about my family, you know. My mom, she also worked for the city of New York. And she went to dance school. She was a ballet dancer and did shows doing ballet. So these are things that I have learned about my family. You know, the ones up until, only ones I know up until is my great-great-grandmother. I don't know any further than that, okay? But those are the ones that made me who I am today, you know? And then you have me, okay? The one that don't take no mess. You know, I'm a little like my great-grandmother. My grandmother, Doris. I have a little bit of her ways, you know, when it comes. When you see me go off and ready to bust a nigga in the head, that's Grandma Doris in me, you know. Because she was the one that didn't take no mess from nobody, okay. And I have her blood running through my veins, so I understand why Do we have uncles and cousins and stuff that was the same way? Probably do. But for right now, only one that I know is my grandma Doris. But I also know that my family carried themselves in a respectful manner, and people always respected them. No matter what they did wrong, they always got a lot of respect. And that's why I'm the same way. I get respect because we treat people kind, we love people, you know, we help people. And this is what my family stood for, okay? And this is what you have to look at when you look at your family and you lost a loved one, you lost a mom, you lost a dad, you know, and you look at yourself and you say, well, that is my father, that is my mother, you know, and what would they do in this situation? What would they do during a crisis? You know, what would they do and how would they handle certain things? Now, there's people that's still alive that knew my people, okay? So if I got out here and start acting a crazy, crazy fool, they're going to say, oh, hold on. Now, she know Tina wouldn't allow that. Or, excuse me, Grandma Tina, because they used to call my great-grandmother, everybody called her Grandma Tina, or Miss Tina, okay? I hear people saying that. They be saying, oh, Tina turning in her grave, seeing her child acting a fool. You know? And these are the things that we need to stray away from. Just like, matter of fact, I'm going to use my closet, for instance. Now, my grandmother, she lived in the Riverside area of Manhattan, which we also call Harlem. Riverside, Broadway area. Okay, 47th Street between Broadway and Amsterdam. And my grandmother had a 3-bedroom apartment, and one of her bedrooms was her closet. Okay, she would open up the French doors and go in, and that's why I love French doors, y'all, because I grew up with them. You know, when I be looking at houses, and I be like, oh, this house got a French door. And, you know, like my family members be, you know, looking at me like, okay, it has a French door. I grew up with French doors in my house, you know what I mean? So I'm used to opening up the doors like this, you know? Well, she had a bedroom with French doors, and when you opened it up, it was her closet, okay? And she would have all her hats. My grandmother was big into the church hats, shoes. Oh, my God. That's where I get it from, y'all. You know, it's not that I want to be like this. It runs through my blood, you know? It could be an addiction, but I mean, it is what it is. I love shoes, you know? And my grandmother, Grandma Juan, Grandma Tina Juan, okay? Even my mother would come at me about me buying shoes, you know? And that's two. That's Tina too, okay? And she would just go off of me like, you keep buying all these shoes. You can't wear all these shoes. And I'm like, Mommy, I like shoes. I like shoes. And when I look back at my grandmother, Tina, one, she's the reason why I'm the way I am. Okay? So this is what, why we have to respect and love our ancestors. And why we have to analyze why we're the way we are. Okay, let me close my bathroom door, y'all. Because the toilet is running. And it bothers me. I don't know if it's bothering y'all, but it bothers me. But I'm going to close this bathroom door so I don't have to hear it. Ugh, I hate that. When that toilet starts running, I hate it. I hate to hear water running, period. So, I had to close that bathroom door. But anyway, getting back to what I was saying about who we are made up to be, you know, we have no choice. It's our blood, okay, running through our veins. So we get a lot of the same ways as our family members. Now, if it's negativity, okay, we have to learn to fight that, of course, okay, because we have some family members that had a lot of negativity and they might have passed away. And we're saying, well, why do we get this urge or this feeling to want to act out or do something negative? Because it's running through your blood. Okay? But you have to learn to fight it because you know it wasn't right. Okay? And just like fighting an addiction. You know, you have to overcome certain things. And that's what beating generational curses are about, people. When there's negative that you've seen in your family, okay, and we say, okay, we're going to erase this part. This part got to go. But I'm going to hold on to the rest of it, okay? And that's like with me. Certain things in my family, I had to just let go, okay? No, we're not going to do this one. Okay, I'm going to fight this to the bitter end in my soul. We will get rid of this in our family. Okay? When it comes to other things, if it was good and you want to hold on to it, you hold on to it. And that makes it a lot easier for us to go through the grieving process, you know. Like with my mom, I'm going to use my mom for instance. You know, I grieved really hard with her. And I'm going to tell y'all why. Because it was unexpected. One, I never experienced, I thought that I would have to experience her passing away so fast. You know, because people go through illnesses, you know, and they overcome it. And I thought I was going to be able to buy my way out of it, you know. And I'm going to just keep it real with y'all. I thought I was going to be able to buy my way out of it, you know. I got money. I'm going to put my mother in the finest doctors, you know, and get her the finest help that she need, you know, and that was my theory, you know, and I'm going to just keep it real with y'all, okay? I was going through, I don't know what I was going through, but I said, I got the money. She going to live, you know, and that's just the way I, you know, looked at it at the time. But I've learned some things, people. No matter how much money you have, you know, you could be a billionaire, and if it's meant for you to die, you're going to die, you know. But she had a choice to also save herself as well, you know. I could at least try to put all my money out there and save my mom, you know. And y'all could read that in my book, That Boxer. And that's why I wrote about it, because it was a serious time for me. When my mother was going through that stage of cancer, and I lived in one state and she lived in another. It was really difficult. People don't even know, you know. And I was ready to leave my job, you know. And my mother said to me, who gonna pay my rent if you leave me a job? I'm not dead yet, you know. And I was like, Mom, what is wrong with you, you know? Like, why are you accepting this, you know? She was like, Jackie, you can't quit. You got to pay my bills. And I'm like, you're right. Okay, Mommy. You know, like, you know, and I'll never forget talking to her. I was at the Mars supermarket in Edgewood. I was trying to pick up some stuff for dinner. I'll never forget this day. And I had called her while I was walking because I used to like to talk to my mother in a quiet space, you know, and being at home with all the kids and they running around asking me 50 questions. Mom. I could never really focus on my mother, you know. So I would talk to my mom on my way home from work. It would be like a 30 to 45 minute drive due to traffic. So that would be the time for me and my mother every single day of my life, okay? Except for the days that I was off and I would talk to her in the evening. Like after, you know, she get off of work. But on the days that I worked, that was my time to talk to my mom. And I was going to the market. She was at the doctor when I was coming from work, so I couldn't call her. I did call her, but she was like, I'm at the doctor. I'll be home soon. I said, okay. So I called my mom back when I got to the market. And, you know, I told her, I said, well, Mom, what I'm thinking about doing, because you shouldn't be going to these doctors by yourself. I need to be there to see what's going on and see what help, so we can get you the best help possible. So she was like, okay. And then she was like, well, how are you going to do that? Are they going to pay you at your job? And I said, well, they're going to give me leave, but they're not going to pay me. You know, I did have a couple of dollars in the bank, but it wasn't. The thing that I didn't recognize was, if you don't have money coming in and you're spending money, the money's going to go away. Okay. And that, I wasn't thinking about that, but she thought about it instantly. Wow. You know, Jackie, I don't care how much you got in the bank. if you ain't got no money coming in and we don't know how long this process is going to be, we're going to fold. The family is going to fold. So I'm like, damn, what am I going to do? You know, so I had to think about these things, you know, and I didn't know what to do. And that's when she came up with that. I'm not dead yet. My bills still need to be paid, you know. So my theory from that point was to bring my mother with me, you know, to go and get her and move her out of the Bronx and bring her to Maryland. That was my theory. And then all I had to worry about was paying one household bills. You know what I'm saying? I only had one household versus two households to take care of. You know, that was my theory. But, you know, she wound up passing away before that happened, you know, and I was in the process of doing that right before she died, you know. So it wasn't meant to happen. I don't know if God didn't want me to have all that extra stress, or maybe God knew that it was going to be very, very overwhelming for me. I don't know what was the reason why she passed away so quick, okay? And she didn't die from the cancer. That was the thing. You know, her heart was weak. Okay, that's why she died. And I'm telling you this. And not only was her heart weak, her sugar was up. Okay, but I know why her sugar was up, because she had been eating candy, because the cancer medication craves sugar. And I didn't learn this until later, until after she passed away, that when you're taking cancer medication, it makes you crave a lot of sugar. So the medicine that she was taking is really what harmed her, you know, and her heart was so weak to deal with different surgeries and stuff like that to help her live throughout this cancer process. Okay, so it killed her pretty fast, you know what I mean? And I wasn't there to monitor her, you know, so like if I was living in the same household with her, I would have been like, no, mommy, you're not having that candy. You know, eat some fruit, you know, because she would sit in her bedroom and eat candy. And I would have been there to be like, take it from her. You know, she probably would have been mad and cursed me out. But I know that it would have harmed her. I would have gave her a smoothie. Here, take this smoothie. You know what I mean? However, this is what happened with my mother's death, you know, and it really like got to me. And it was hard for me to overcome her death, you know. However, I found it more comfortable to just keep Tina alive, you know, in my heart every day. And the same with the rest of my family members, you know. So every now and again, y'all would see me do something that Tina would do, because it's in my blood anyway, you know. So I would do something that Tina does, and it's because I'm keeping her alive within me. Okay, and I think I talked about this once before. I might have talked about it on Facebook or whatever the case may be. But it just makes it a little bit easier to grieve by keeping your, you know, your family members alive in your heart and living out the things that they would want you to live out and do it the right way, you know. And this is why I'm the person I am today, you know, and I try to respect my people, you know, even though they're dead. You have to respect them. You have to respect the name, you know, for what you stand for. Because even though they're gone, they're still looking down from heaven, you know? And sometimes you be in your house and you see some strange things going on. They may be trying to tell you something. Or you take you go to bed and you wake up and you had a dream about your people. And you say, uh-oh, they're trying to tell me something. And then you got to start investigating. What are they talking about? You know? I didn't understand a lot of things about family, you know, and it's not like we wake up and we know about the ancestry life of family, you know, and this is why I'm talking about this, because if our family members didn't teach us about it, and we have some people that hasn't been taught, you know, then how would you know, you know? There's a lot of people out here that has lost their moms and they're young, lost their fathers and they're young, and you know, just because they're dead, they feel like, oh, and I'm grown. You know, I don't have nobody to tell me what to do anymore, even if I'm doing wrong. You know, who's going to be there to tell you? And this is when some of us, when we know a person, you know, Like, I have a couple of friends on Facebook. If I do something crazy, they'll step in. You know, especially the older ones, you know, because I got some friends that watched my family, you know, that knew my family, watched me grow from a little one, you know. And they may say, well, no, you know, Tina wouldn't allow that. And I be like, ugh. You know, but I'm glad that they're there. And they know my family and what they stood for. Okay? And they're willing to step in and say, hey, because that's not how your people rolled. Because you are a part of them, even though they're dead. Okay? They're still a part of you. You know, y'all listen to the song Beyonce made about ancestors. You know, learning about your ancestors. It's nothing wrong with learning about who you are. Because these were your people. Okay? And respecting the name. You know, I have a friend, you know, his mom wanted so much for him. You know, she must have knew she was going to pass away. You know, I'm not going to bring up no names because you know how I do. I try to keep people's stuff private. But I will tell you the story. She wanted so much for her son. So much, you know. And she asked me, you know, please help him, you know. And I used to look at her like, why is she telling me this? You know, does she know something? I don't know. You know, she might have been sick, you know, and didn't tell nobody. You know, and just wanted to find the right people for her child to be around when she leaves. Because she didn't want people to take advantage of him. Because when you meet new people every single day, you don't know, you know, how these people are and what they're going to do and what their motives are. You know, so you try to find good people to bring in your circle. So if something happened to you, you know, they would be there for your people, your kids and your family, you know, to support them the right way. However, he's not understanding that because she didn't teach him about ancestries and generational wealth and family. Okay. And the names. Okay. We hold these names, whether they, some of these names are slave names or not. We still hold these names, okay? And they belong to us, whether the slave master gave it to us or not, you know? They belong to us. And we built families based on these names, okay? And that's what make you who you are, okay? That name, what you stand for. You know, just like when I married into the Richardson family, my ex-boss, he said to me, God bless his soul, old man, he just used to say some things, you know, because he was very prejudiced, but he gave me a job and I worked my job until I was tired, you know. However, he said, I said to him, am I going to get a raise? And he said, well, we know your name is Richardson. But, no, you're not going to get rich, right? So, you know, I didn't know how to take it, you know. Are you saying this because you gave me a raise, you didn't give me a big raise where I'm going to be rich over it, or are you saying it to down me? Because he was the type of person that would down a person, so I didn't know how to take it, you know. He said to me on one time, and I think I had told y'all about this, I didn't think that black women worked, you know. And I told him, I said, I'm from New York. This is what we do, you know. So I didn't know how to take his, what he was saying to me, you know. But when you read up on the Richardson name, the Richardson name was very wealthy, okay. You read up on a Dowdy name, a lot of them were psychotic, you know. And I believe it because a lot of my family members are psychotic, you know, and I'm laughing with y'all, but this is the facts, you know what I mean? So these last names and these, bloodlines mean a lot, people. And you know, when I get off of here, for those that's listening, you need to find out what your name mean, you know, and what the family name was about back in the day, you know, long time ago, so you can understand why some of the things that you go through are like the way it is, you know. We have to take more pride in who we are and who we want to be, you know, because if it was things that our family name, like I said, did and it was wrong, we need to learn to fix that and move on. Okay, let it go and just move on. You know, we're going to continue to talk about letting certain negative things go so we can live a certain way. Of course, life would never be perfect. We're going to always have challenges. However, if life was so easy, you know, we would just be like mummies walking around. So sometimes we like these challenges. You know, we just don't like the real hard ones that's going to break our lives down tremendously, you know, like the addictions or rage, being a murderer, you know, being so hard on your kids to where they want to run away, you know. We have to learn those balances and change some things, people. This is the new age, and we have to learn to let some of the stuff of our ancestors go and hold on to some of the things that our ancestors has given us, you know. Granted, you know, some things that they used to do just didn't make sense to me, you know. And we had talked about that one time on, they was talking about some diseases right before the COVID dropped. We was on Facebook or Instagram, I can't remember. And we was talking about a disease, some type of disease that was out back when my great-grandmother was coming up. And every time I walk with my shoes off, barefooted, she would say, I'm going to get the claps, okay? And I kept saying, what is the claps? What is the claps? And the claps was a venereal disease, okay? But she would falsely tell me that this is what I would get just so I wouldn't walk barefoot. You know, that's stuff that we want to leave. That's another thing. They would say some crazy things back in the day. And I even find myself doing it. You know what I mean? What's another one? My grandmother Doris used to always say that. Yeah, so-and-so down in yonder. Yonder? Where's yonder? You know, who is yonder? Or Jibipsy, you know, so-and-so is down and is in Jibipsy. Well, where's Jibipsy? You know, these are the ways they talked and made up all these different words that we knew nothing about. And here we are old now. I'm 50 years old, still trying to figure out what is Jibipsy? What is the claps? What is this? What is that? You know what I mean? So those are some of the things that I want to remove from my family. Okay. Some of the things that they used to say and dishonestly give me meanings of things just so I could do what they want me to do, you know. So that's one of the things that I'm moving out of my family, okay. And that's what I'm talking about. Certain things, if it was a bad outcome, to where it can embarrass you or make you look crazy, you let it go. Okay, but then all the good things, the love, the family, you know, how they would expect you to be, you hold on to those things, you know, and respect the name for what it is, you know. I always stand back and think and analyze, and that's why I tell y'all the process of thinking is a big, big thing, you know, especially in this time that we have right now. Process of thinking should be utilized in almost everything that we do, you know. And even when I put on clothes, like this morning, I'm talking about Tina. Blue is her favorite color. I'm not into blue like that, for real. I buy blue clothes, my mama's favorite color. I represent blue for her, you know. But that was my process of thinking this morning, you know. I'm going to represent my mom today, you know, and put on blue. you know, and that was my process, you know. So these are the things that we have to do to keep our families alive, keep the names alive. You know, not only just a color, y'all. Don't take this literal, what I'm saying. I'm talking about in life in general, you know. Even when we're